Hello and welcome to Business on the Wire. At last count, India was the fourth worst affected country in the world in the number of infections and sat at 9th spot in terms of a death toll. State-wise, Maharashtra has been hit the hardest because of Mumbai and Pune, Chennai for Tamil Nadu, and Delhi occupy the next two spots. But before I start unpacking what's going on in these metros through this COVID crisis, I want you to consider some numbers. India's public hospitals have a little over 7 lakh beds, including about 36,000 in intensive care units, about 1,700 ventilators. That's according to a recent study by the Center for Disease Dynamics, Economics and Policy and the Princeton University. In 2017, data from the National Health Profile showed that India has a little over 1 million allopathic doctors to treat a population of 1.3 billion people. Only around 10% work in the public health sector. Broken up another way, there's one government doctor for every 10,190 people, one government hospital bed for every 2,046 people, and one state-run hospital for every 90,000 plus people. Stunning, right? The National Health Policy of the same year stated that it aimed to strengthen health systems by increasing public health expenditure to about 2.5% by 2025 and increasing the state health spending to more than 8% of their budget by 2020. But here's a look at the budgetary allocations set out by the centre and various states this year versus what they estimated in the previous year. Remember, states like Delhi actually presented their budget in the middle of the corona crisis. Delhi's budget was passed on the 24th of March, one day before lockdown. In his piece on the crisis, Christopher Jaffrelot observes that as per the National Health Profile 2018, India's public health spending is less than 1% of the country's GDP. That's lower than some of its neighbours, countries like Bhutan, that's at 2.5%, Sri Lanka 1.6%, Nepal also higher at 1.1%. In fact, according to the WHO, India finishes second from the bottom amongst the 10 countries of its region for its percentage spending of GDP on public health. Health is a state subject. Disparities and inequities in the quality of care and access to health, of course, vary widely, not just between states, but also between urban and rural areas. However, in the case of COVID, the hardest hit have been the densely populated, cheek by jowl living metro cities. It's the unfortunate reality of the infection. Denser the population, higher the infection rate. To the central government's mind, though, none of these figures actually prove that there is community transmission, which is generally accepted as meaning that someone who gets the virus had no known contact with another confirmed case, nor traveled from a country badly affected by the pandemic. Basically implying the virus is moving freely in the community. India, though, says there's no official accepted definition for the term. Why? I spoke with K. Sujata Rao, who's former Secretary of Health and Family Welfare with the Government of India, to ask her just that.
Well, you know, as DG ICMR had said in his last press meet, that India does not have community transmission. He's technically right, because India is a huge country and there are several areas where there is no sign of COVID. There are several areas where there is a very localized transmission. But there are several areas, namely the three cities of Chennai, Delhi, and Mumbai, where under no stretch of imagination can you say there's no community transmission. Of course there is community transmission, and overall, if you say that you've crossed more than 300,000 infections, and to still say it's not community transmission is just being in denialism. And why are they denying this? I don't know, because it has serious policy implications. Once you say you have community transmission, then your strategies have to change, your focus has to change. And when you don't accept that there is community transmission, then you stick to your old strategies, which are not going to work. So that is the implication of definitions. And I think the sooner they come out with being correct and true to the data, the better for the country.
There is a twist in this healthcare breakdown tale, making it different from what we may have experienced before. And here's why it's pinching so hard. Hardships of any kind generally, but medical and health related ones specifically, have never been a problem for the privileged. Suddenly, COVID has turned that on its head. Beds aren't readily available, doctors aren't as easily accessible, and rich lives have become as compromised as poor ones. Privately, doctors have communicated to their close ones that they can't really guarantee any special favors if indeed someone is seriously afflicted by the pandemic. Colony RWAs are trying to organize emergency equipment like oxygenators with rentals from anywhere between 7,000 to 10,000 a month. Families are buying smaller devices like pulse oximeters to monitor their oxygen and pulse levels, and everyone is generally just praying really hard because this is what Atmanirbhar healthcare looks like. There's also a raging debate around the evil profiteering private hospitals versus the people, which brings us to the very important question: could this have been dealt with better?
I think they have a very strong argument. It's very, very clear from what is happening today. For example, Telangana has set rates for private sector engagement today. I mean, what were they doing all these 3 months? They were not allowing them to test. They were not allowing any engagement from the private sector. They asked them to shut down everything except emergencies. That was their attitude. And in Delhi also, I think it was only yesterday or day before when they tried to engage with the private sector. And this has been such a self-defeatist policy that it's very unfortunate, because we all know again that the people who need hospitalization are not the mildly symptomatic ones. Then the people who are dying, the whole exercise, as the Prime Minister said right in his first speech to the nation, was saving lives. That's the important thing. There'll be millions of infections. That should not worry us so much. I may be asymptomatic for all I know. It doesn't matter. But what we have to worry is that lives should not be lost. And who are the people who are dying are very clear: those with comorbidities and those who are very old, the elderly. Now, these are the people who need ICU treatment with oxygen or without ventilators, or with ventilator and oxygen, that kind. Now, where are that kind of specialized treatment and that infrastructure? 80% of it is in the private sector. You know that. Didn't the government know that? They know it. So why did they not engage with them beforehand? We are not interested in a bed for a mild symptomatic person. That you can always put them anywhere, and they've come up with a protocol almost 2-3 weeks ago for home quarantine, which is the right way to go about. So when you know that you don't have the tertiary care facility and it's the private sector, the rate card, the costings, the negotiations, the engagement with the private sector should have been done 2 months beforehand. That, you know, these are the number of beds we need, and if and when the need arises, we will call upon you to earmark those many beds, and this is what the treatment package is going to be about, and these are the protocols, and this amount we will reimburse for the patients that you treat. That's the way you go about. And unfortunately, the process, for reasons that I cannot guess, has not happened, and that's very unfortunate.
So here are some questions to ask the center and state governments around this full-blown healthcare crisis. Number one, why wasn't allocation hiked meaningfully for a crucial item like health over the last 2 years for a country that is so far back on the spectrum of healthcare availability? Number two, what were state governments and the centre doing during the lockdown to prepare for the surge in cases post-lockdown? Was there any engagement with the private sector to actually chalk out capacity addition or partnership or some kind of fixed cost payment in order to work together when numbers surge? Number three, who is accountable for this crisis, and what are the consequences for the grief and suffering that people are facing? Healthcare has never been a top priority because the middle class has never turned to public hospitals for help. As private and public hospitals get completely overwhelmed with this COVID pandemic, it's time to ask what governance should mean to us when we vote.
I don't think the word is repercussions, but there could be a few takeaways if we have really learned our lessons. Because in India, one never knows, you know, the entire... The politicians just flirt with health. Now there's a crisis, so they're all worried about it. But it will take them less than a second to forget about health when things get sorted out. And so, you know, if they're really genuinely concerned to see that such a horrific experience India is not subjected to in future, then what they need to do is to give outstanding and disproportionate attention to public health. They have to improve the public health delivery mechanism. They have to improve the public health. They have to invest money on building up public health capacity. They need to have an NCDC which works with as much efficiency as the CDC in America. They need to have an epidemiological public health force with epidemiologists and biostatisticians and public health experts in every state. And there must be, I believe, that kind of a process can only start when there's a full-fledged department for public health. So, you know, public health is not, RML is not public health, that's a public hospital. So I'm making a distinction between the government facilities, which of course need to be strengthened and ramped up. But I'm talking about the public health discipline, which consists of the science of epidemiology and ability to predict infections and dealing with infections, having in-depth knowledge about the viral behavior in humans and so on and so forth. So those areas have been badly neglected, and we are paying the price for that neglect.